Good evening, everyone. I am very honored tonight to introduce the work of David Clarabaut. David is an extraordinary artist, and in the course of his career, he managed to impose himself as one of the leading European artists. His production spans from photography and mainly to video. And what is striking about his work is the consistency with which, through which, the notion of time is explored. And I think that from the very beginning, when I encountered his work, I was surprised about the subtleness of how what we assume and take for granted, like the flowing of time, can be manipulated, inverted, and appear in a totally unconventional and inspiring way. And I think that for this specific reason, David Clarabaut and his production has an important role in the reflection on the notion of energy that the cluster aims to explore. Again, not in a very literal way, but as an opportunity to question the transformation of the reality that David so beautifully can express with the work of video in the most unexpected and poetic way. So for me, it's a great honor tonight to welcome David Clarabaut. Thank you very much.
I've started my early work as a lithographer. I was trained at a certain point, even I was a master lithographer. I had the title of master lithographer. I could do a lot in etching as well. And I was mainly trained as a craftsman, also in drawing, and then later on transitioned to painting. But somewhere in the middle of my postgraduate course in the Higher Institute in Antwerp, that all kind of collapsed. And I think that had a lot to do with the fact that I, as a child, I was a real child artist. I had been drawing and painting since I was 7 or 8. And I had the feeling that I'd seen it all and that I'd tried everything, but nothing which was actually my own. And I think I realized at that point, must have been somewhere 1993, 94, that most of the source material that I had used for my paintings and my drawings had been found footage, essentially photographs, found photographs. And for a while I decided to abandon all practice of creating painting and works of art, in order to stay with all that photographic material that I had collected over the years. Over the years was a big thing, because I was not actually, I'd not been working for that long, but to essentially to work with all the photographic material that I had. And so in this few years that come in between and after the academy, there's a kind of practice going on, which is that of, I don't know, do you say it, abstinence? In fact, deciding not to do and not to act instead of wanting to produce. And I stayed with my material for a long time, and that took me up until my visit at the Rijksacademy in Amsterdam, where the fact that I did nothing was badly received by the tutors, of course. But it was essential for me, and it created what I have called later on some kind of auto-animation, a kind of imagination that we apply on images that have stayed for a long time with us, and to which we have looked for a long time, whether they're pictures of family or friends or loved ones, or pictures that are just inside of our kind of intimate circle of life. And this auto-animation basically caused the first steps from collecting photography or reproduction simply to making very simple video animations. And the first work that I will show you is not actually video animation, but it's a small piece of video that pretends to be an animation from a still life. And I had a cat and I had a bird in my apartment, and I had also an attic. And in that attic, I had built a small cage, like a confined room in which neither the bird or the cat could escape. And what do you guess? Of course, they're put together in that cage. One would expect they fight, to say the least. But they stayed peacefully for 90 minutes. That's 9-0, the duration of an analog Hi-8 tape. And I have here a small excerpt of them sitting next to one another. Unfortunately, today many people still think this is my best work. As you can see, the quality of an artist beginning to work with video and knowing nothing about it is quite terrible. So the conservation of the piece was not so excellent. I don't show the work on a large screen like this. I usually show it on a small monitor in a corner, somewhere hidden. And it takes about, I think it takes about 7 or 8 minutes, this fragment of the cat and the bird. But there were many other positions. In a nutshell, it's for me what kind of triggered my work, and that's why I opened my keynote presentation at this work, is because it was like this thing that made the whole balance for me clear between whether I would work with photography or whether I would actually start to work a bit more with video. And what I liked about video at that time already, as it was still kind of in between analog and digitally produced, was that it could appear and disappear. So in other words, that it did not have the aura of the object of art, to which I was a slave for many, many years, including all the time when I was a painter. And so I felt it like a liberation. But of course, something that is already in this work and that then comes back in most of my works later is this paradox, between the living paradox, I would say, between two worlds which are, or two irreconcilable realities, one could say, which are brought together on a single surface. And with the single surface, I mean the flatness of the projection or the television or the screen. And philosophically, that flatness for me is a true problem, because it, via phenomena like pornography, it shows that we do have a very physical, almost existential link to film and video, as where we might know exactly that it's a fake, but we still believe it's happening, because it's happening and it's moving in front of our eyes. So essentially, for me, that this is an installation view, that triggered quite a lot of work, which is in a contemporary conception of movement, is related to standstill, maybe death, sometimes boredom. Children usually don't like my work because it's not. It's often, it takes a number of minutes before the piece really starts functioning. I'm not going to show this piece because I have to skip a little bit. Might start perhaps with then the first animation that I had made, which is also a piece that has degraded slightly in quality over the years, although it was produced digitally. I had found a postcard in a book, as I found and still find most of my ideas in books, in the library or whatever. And this postcard showed this monumental tree in a southern Holland landscape with some people posing in front of it, probably rather proud that they were able to be photographed. And so this was taken around the 1910s. And probably reading at the same time Susan Sontag, I got this idea to do something with both the very literal of present and past. And present is represented by the ongoing movement of the leaves, which is more of a caressing of the surface rather than an action or rather than a movement. And on the other hand, the witnessing or the certitude that we are watching a picture from the past, namely its composition, its ingredients, the mill, the people, the vagueness of the picture, and of course the black and white. And when it's not so much done from a concept as well as from a phenomenon, which is that the tree is still existing, still living, while none of the environment is still as it used to be. The village is overgrown with houses and is a suburb now, and the tree still exists, but obviously all the people are gone. So in a simple way, by using a phenomenon that is more like a test, a witness of something rather than an actor, I try to tell a story. And all my work is about storytelling, but also about the impossibility of trying to convince anybody about something. From the beginning, I had rather precise installation instructions. 3 by 4 meters for a long time used to be my favorite size. It brought those films that I had made into the gallery space as being pictures, hanging, not hanging pictures, but hardly moving pictures, and pictures which didn't have a beginning, neither an end, really. Again, I'm going to skip a bit, and I'm going to go to a piece that I had made a few years later, which is titled, after the original photograph, Kindergarten Antonio Santelia. And again, which is a work that has no beginning and no end, and that is just ongoing, floating like time would be floating without a warning of a beginning and an end. And as such, it's not a real video piece in terms that it doesn't address you directly. It's just there. And it's part of the same series of the previous work, the Rurlo, Bokurloschewijk work. But it has, despite the fact that it has a similar structure with the moving trees, it tells a completely different story in a way. I had taken this photograph from an image from an architecture book, and I had a big love for architectural reproductions because they represent humankind or urbanism as wedding photographs the wedding photographs of urbanism are a little bit like the architectural photographs. They're new, they're bright, and they position the human being in a perfect relation to its backdrop, namely the building. So I had taken this picture from a reproduction on the Kindergarten Antonio Santelia from Giuseppe Terragni, modified the picture slightly as to give it a bit more contrast and order. And this orderly sense is throughout the picture there, of course. There's a balance between black and white, and the kids all have the uniform on. And the young trees are as young as the kids, but they obviously, in their movement, are surviving and are the only witnesses that we have left, which is kind of the undercurrent rhetoric of the piece. And for me, this work was important in the sense that I looked at it as an answer to a problem that much photography is posing, and that is, how does the past, its past witness, relate to how we look at it today? Whether this is 2010 or whether it's going to be 2015, but how is it relating to, how is it the past relating to the present? And through these subtle interventions I'm trying to mediate in a non-conflictuous way between what's past and what's present. And in the case of Terani, we of course have the entire political problem of fascist Italy and all that it has produced, not to mention fascist Germany. And I've worked, in a few occasions, I've worked on architecture that had to do, that it was related somehow to Italian interbellum architecture. And so I thought, how can part of this photography be transferred to the present without losing its sense of originality and its sense of innocence also in a way, where the original intentions and richness in the composition and, of course, the utopia of the beautiful contrasting light and the order in society, etc., how all those things are, of course, present in the original photographs, how these elements could be transposed into the present without a sense of conflict or without a sense of drama or even trauma around them. And this has been part of my quest up until now, is how do you... I feel myself like a diplomat between conflicting situations within one single picture. That's briefly how I would describe myself. I sometimes also make sketches in preparation to the, or perfectioning the compositions. They look huge on screen, but they're very small. We might perhaps then skip to, we haven't had sound yet, so we might have a bit of sound. I will show you 5 minutes of this work. Goes on like that for another 54 minutes, I think, and then it loops imperceptibly. It's basically a still image, a collage that made digitally, and a still sound, I would also say, which is kind of in between sound that I took from film, and which is meant to connect two scenes together. And I was hoping to make a very simple piece which was all about action about to occur, but never does so. And it's a bit of a balance, a negotiation between where a piece or where a picture loses its energy, where it becomes just a composition, or how long does it in fact keeps on questioning the position of the woman in the right and the three people to the left. And I made this work quite a long time ago in 1999. So I consider it a very simple exercise in waiting and being waited for. Again, installed real size, kind of life size, as as to reflect a little bit the positions also of the spectator. And then shortly after that, I made my first interactive piece. As you can see, I've stolen quite a lot of my footage from architectural photographs here and there, often black and white, often from in between the two world wars, because I liked so much the use of very high contrasted light, which for a former painter like myself was great material to work with in composition. And I make this this insertion of a man and a girl, and the girl is making a drawing. And as the spectator comes into the room, the man gives a signal to the girl that somebody has entered, and she quits the drawing for a moment and looks at you, just briefly without actually saying hello, and then after that just continues her drawing. So there's this sense of non-communication in a way. She's seen you, you've seen her, but you have both your presences, hers on screen, yours in the room, so there's nothing more than that. And I've actually quite more often used this sort of interrupted communication. There's nothing more pretentious than actually wanting to say that the piece could be interactive. I think the red lights on the street are probably more interactive than most interactive art that we are confronted with. Then a brief, very short, I'm not going to show the entire 16 minutes, which are, I think, on this file. Retrospection, I'm going to show you a few minutes. My apologies, somehow it stops. Got stuck. So this piece was about working with a very, very connotated and dated photograph, obviously from a clear past, people that have become anonymous to everybody, and trying to reframe them and in fact trying to bring back their gazes into our eyes from the past. It's a very simple piece. It goes on, I think, for about 60 minutes, and it zooms into a number of those kids. Then the second interactive piece that I had made is in 2000, got no title. It's simply a portrait of myself as a man who is walking around the scene, and he's essentially doing circles around the scene for as long as there's nobody visiting the room in which this piece is projected. The moment somebody comes in, there is a detector, a trigger, a sensor, which is preventing him to come back. So he's just walking away. In the best case, you can still see him moving away with the shadow along the wall there, but he's never coming back. So as a spectator, you are just left with two big black holes. And I've stolen, but that's just an anecdote, I've stolen this picture partly from a work by Robert Irvine, one of the pieces that he did, I think must have been the end of the 60s. It's a light piece, it's a wonderful piece with a moving light of the day. In 2001, I did a piece which became rather successful, I think, in large part due to the wrong reasons. I had this idea. I had seen a picture in a book again. It was a black and white photograph taken by a Japanese photographer during the Vietnam War. And he was on a location in central Vietnam at the moment where Americans, by accident, shot one of their own aircraft, which was landing on this airstrip below. His photograph was a photograph which was occupied. There were people occupying the foreground, a few cars. There was a tent. There was a little fire. Somebody was cooking something, and there was also this little barn on the background to the right there, which is still there. And I decided to embark on something with that image, partly because I was very intrigued by the fact that the problem of the image hangs right in the middle of it. And as a trained composer, we always like to avoid central occupation of the main subject, especially a subject like that in the picture. But I thought I might perhaps look for a solution in negotiating in this picture between the past and the now by going back to Vietnam, looking up the exact same landscape where the drama had occurred, and by recording the motion or the movement of light across this landscape. Vietnam has this wonderful phenomena which I call sun showers, but which is term which does not really exist in English, I think, which are very rapidly moving clouds and sunlight, and which create this wonderful movement of light over the landscape. And so I'd simply applied that motion, which is kind of caressing the landscape, over the wings of the aircraft, a thing which is probably a bit difficult to notice in this low-res presentation here. And I was probably associating with many other pictures somehow. I was thinking of the etchings of the late Rembrandt, where he has this very strong chiaroscuro in the picture, and this almost kind of religious light going on there. And it amused me in a way that all that could kind of occupy the same surface. So, as such, the problem no longer becomes a problem of the central thing in the composition, but becomes kind of spread out over the landscape. It becomes a question from which is posed through light, through the motion of light, and which actually reflects back on the 1967 photograph. Sorry. It's here shown installed rather large in the Kunstmuseum in St. Gallen in Switzerland. This, by the way, is a picture that I never reproduce, obviously, because I don't have the rights for it. But that's the original image that gave me the idea. Then I'd always been, since 1994, I think, I've slowly and without real clear reasons very often, I've been collecting architectural photography, not as a collector of unique pieces, but as somebody who's very interested in the way photographers and architects together depict the ideal circumstances for the human body. And I very often like to use architectural structures as a backdrop for my figures. And this comes back in various stories and subjects and contexts. And one of them is the stack. I think it's my second color piece that I had made in 2002. Which is a high definition work. It's important to look at it in a very precise scale. And it's a dialogue, for me it's a dialogue between foreground, middle plan, and backdrop. It reminds a little bit of some of the etchings with the counterlight that we know of Piranesi. And where he uses this wonderful technique of first revealing what's on the backdrop, and then slowly your eyes goes to the middle ground, and at the end, he actually, the core of the storytelling happens in the foreground. But the foreground, funny enough, is enveloped in darkness. And so rather unconsciously than conceptually, I reproduced this idea, working with a homeless person in Houston, in Texas. So I undertook a travel to Texas and looked for a location which could be recorded against the sun and which also allowed for a very balanced composition. And the projection is quite large. It goes up to 13 meters in basis with a very big projector. There's a sense of beautiful light going on in those 36 minutes. You see the sun crossing the columns, going down. Actually, it's a reversed sunrise, which goes down the other way. Clever spectators notice that it's going the wrong way, I suppose, which I sometimes regret I did this, because it's silly to have to answer to the sun moving in the wrong direction. But in the foreground is occupied by this guy who's sleeping there. Who stays immobile for the entire recording of the pictures. And it's photographed in such a way, a bit similar to the Vietnam piece, it's photographed taking a still every 3 seconds during a few hours. And then to connect all those stills and to crossfade them actually very simply. It's a very simple technique. And as such, you get the impression of continuous time, the fluidity of time, without the actual noise of video, without the actual nervousness of a camera turning in real time. So the only thing moving there is basically the sunlight. Because it takes 36 seconds, we're not going to see the man, except maybe I could find him back here, but I don't think there's a sequence. Yeah, we got a bit of fast forward there. So it's a very short piece. And this glorious light not only lights up this environment, which in its ugliness, in its urban ugliness, has also got something really, really beautiful and desolate for that matter. It also, at a certain point, lights up the homeless person in a way which is politically kind of incorrect, because it gives a glorifying impression to poverty. And so it's like his 1.5 minutes of being into the spotlight before it actually covers him up again in shade. So I was thinking not only of a structural, pictorial undertaking like the foreground, the middle ground, and the background, but also on a narrative way. I'm trying to find a manner in which the subject of the poor, which historically has always been a recurrent subject in painting, could be revived, and I could do something with it, perhaps, again in this non-conflictuous manner. This is a view of. This is an installation shot of an exhibition that I did in Athens last year. And as you can see, all the pictures are projected together. I prefer not to use walls that separate the works from one another, if the sound installation, of course, allows it. But I rather work with transparent scrims already since several years. It's a material called banner drape. It's rather cheap and very strong. You can make real walls out of it. And you can project both on the surface, but also straight through it. And it gives an interesting effect in the sense that it projects its light also on other pieces and on people passing by. This is a sketch of the stack, a very early one. This is one of the first works that I think I kind of reconstructed from memory, so to speak. An idea that I got or a picture that I'd seen somewhere, but I didn't actually manage to collect. Then a drawing of how the piece had to be, how the sun had to move. I'm going to skip Piano Player, although I would love to show it, but it's right away 7.5 minutes, might be a bit long for now. I could show it on request later if you like. Rocking Chair in 2003 is again a piece about some kind of compression of space. It shows two projections, and they both show the same situation, basically, of this rather corporal kind of large woman sitting in front of a sunlit house. And you as a spectator come in front of it. It's kind of one-on-one composition. It looks rather monumental. And the piece is installed in such a way that it's central. It takes a central spot in the room. It's not projected on the wall, but it's projected on a very thin wall. And it's got a front and a back projection. In the back projection, we see the exact same situation of the woman, except that time we look from over her shoulders towards a landscape that she's actually observing. And we are confronted with the absence of ourselves, where a moment earlier we were ourselves. There's not only that, but there's also the fact that this woman is triggered by our presence. We go around the screen to leave the room, and that she stops the rocking of her chair, which is in a way is resembling always a little bit like the ticking of a clock. It's four back, it's this ongoing relaxed situation. And she actually does not really turn around to look, but she turns around to listen to the person who has moved past her screen. So I was looking there for a situation which in a way was completely fictitious, because it's non-existent. It's a one world, a black and white world projected on a small surface, a tiny surface, but which nevertheless has a few subtly conflicting questions to ask, namely that of our own bodily presence in relation to the work. Reflecting Sunset from the same year is this second piece that I'd made with Italian architecture in my mind. And I went to the Stazione Marittima in Napoli, just okay, my apologies here. I don't seem to have the video file anymore in. But I can show you the pictures nevertheless. These are a few preparation drawings of this detail from the Stazione Marittima in Napoli, which is this colossal place where ships dock. And I took a fragment of it. It's basically just a group of windows. And by blowing them up and by recording the movement of the sun setting in the windows, they become kind of monumental and become like a building in themselves. One loses the sense of them being a fragment of a building, and they kind of become rather enormous. So the projection itself is almost 10 meters wide, and is projected on a pitch black surface with a very strong video projector. And the reason why I do that is because I was attracted to the fact that the image of sunlight, of a ball of sun, even reproduced on a picture, on a photograph, or in film, nevertheless triggers a bodily experience or a bodily reflex of adapting the eyes. It perhaps does not really so, but it unconsciously reminds you of how it is to look into a light that is far too bright for your own body or for your own eyes. So I kind of associated that with something about modernism, in not only in architecture but as a cultural phenomenon, which was a kind of very beautiful shock, which was too bright to be looked at, and which by consequence caused comes at the same time at a period of enormous conflict and catastrophe. And I was wondering if I would be able to negotiate between, through this setting sun, which is in itself always kind of referring to a day that ends, something that's over, something that comes at the end, and on one hand, and on the other hand, perhaps give a sign of warning that it's still there, that this reflex is still needed, that there is still, that there should not be there should not be this trap of the romanticism of past, either politically or aesthetically. And it may sound a bit like a paradox, knowing the fact that I've used often old-looking images, and that even my recent works still somehow look like they have been produced elsewhere or by somebody else, or maybe they've even been drawn. An interesting anecdote was that at one time, the piece had been acquired by the Museum Boijmans van Beuningen in Rotterdam. And I wasn't able to go there for the installation myself. But I went at the closing day of the exhibition. And it was funny. I was staying there for probably 15 minutes. And I should know the piece by heart. And I was really puzzled because it wasn't moving. And it is, of course, very difficult to observe instantly the motion in the image, which is obviously the idea, that you have to sit and in fact also relax in order to start being able to catch on the piece. But this time it took so long, I thought there's something not right here. And I realized after discussing with the guards that the piece ran from a PC, that since the opening day it had been on pause. And nobody had ever bothered to push the space button again. This is another installation view in Vancouver. it shows reflecting sunset in the back, actually in a bit too bright situation, but that's always the problem with that work, and especially with works that are have a lot to do with composition and with fragile light situations. To the right you can see rocking chair. In the in the background you can see Rurlo. And to the left is a piece that I will come later. It's the Bordeaux piece, which was, for me personally, very important work. Then this work, I will show it to you entirely because it's very, very short. It's a commission made for big productions in collaboration with the New Museum in New York. And it's a number of contributions of artists in video. And it was very, it was like an unlimited edition that was easy to purchase. This piece is about expecting a lot and getting very little in return. You cannot imagine how difficult it was to get that cat out of the forest at the right moment. As you can see, she came out like even like 15 seconds too late. Then a work about basically it's a comment in the margin about, again, about expectation. It's a double projection. The title is The American Car. And it's one situation with filmed from inside the car and the other from outside towards the car. it's shown in such a way that you have to bridge the distance, the same distance by foot as the piece is actually representing. Both camera points of view are about 50 meters away from one another. The other camera point of view is this one. The main difference between the two pictures is not only, of course, the broadness and the claustrophobic, but most of all that the bad weather has stopped. Few stills, drawings. Some production pictures, perhaps, done in a very simple way, renting a car, faking rain in the studio. I wanted to actually make this a long piece with a lot of points of view, so I'd spent probably 10 days working with those people, and in the end I only kept a single point of view, that from behind their backs. These were all different kind of proposals. I used actually this picture for a poster for the exhibition. Yeah, it's inspired on Bullet, yeah. It's not taken from Bullet, but it's the points of view come from the car scenes in Bullet. Yeah, then few installation pictures. So you'd had to walk, this was at the Lehnbachhaus in Munich. You came in, this was the first picture, and then you had to walk 50 meters further, completely down the hall, until from the other side you would see the second picture. That was the second. This is at the Van Abbe Museum in Eindhoven. So then we come to a piece that is very dear to me, because it allowed for me kind of to open up to something new. I had with this piece called The Piano Player, I had started to work very modestly with short film. I was never trained as a filmmaker, really, so I'm completely autodidact. But I did have an assistant who was trained as a filmmaker, and he was very good with light, and we discussed a lot, and out of these discussions with him and with his friends, I decided, actually I got an idea for a piece which would unite something going on in the foreground with something going on in the background in an unlikely way. And the thing going on in the foreground for me was, it had to be a story. I had some vague kind of story in my head, which at that time I was looking at, been looking at Le Mépris by Jean-Luc Godard. And with that story in my head, I went to this place for which I was invited by the owner of the house in France, near Bordeaux. And she said, I own this very famous house, could you have a look, and maybe could you think of an integration in that house of your work? I had seen from a few reproductions that this must be indeed a very well-known house. It appeared to be a house by Rem Koolhaas, one of his best known. On top of that, and it was full of little details, little and big details, which made it impossible to make any kind of integration or whatsoever, because it was so full of itself in a way. It was very adventurous with light. It was great, actually, the way it relates to the movement of the light of day. And that gave me the idea to shoot a film there instead of trying to propose a piece that would be integrated on location. So I vaguely on me grew this idea of making a piece that is set in this posh villa, minimalist villa, owned by far too wealthy people who are able to afford this minimalism, and who a very simple story with three people, where a man, a father, and his son, and the girlfriend of the son, which is actually having an affair with the father. So something almost too simple to be true, but that's usually how it goes in films. So I said, okay, that's maybe a good starting point for creating a sense of foregrounding. That is my understanding of the term foregrounding, my own interpretation of it, where actors occupy the foreground, where you think you're watching a short film, and it basically, the short film is instrumentalized to make you forget, as a spectator, that there's something else going on in the film, which is more subtle, more slow, and which connects to real time, which connects to, in fact, the sun moving around the house very slowly from morning until evening. So there I went on this embarked on this crazy idea to shoot this short film, which I thought would be about 10 minutes, to shoot it 75 times. So, and to make it appear that the film would be looped, so that the people who would actually come into the gallery would say, okay, we've seen it 10 minutes, we've seen it, it starts again. So, but what have I seen? There's no narrative clue actually of what the film has been about. It's mediocre acted. There's all sorts of stuff which is not right about it. And that, but in after these 10 minutes, actually the short film makes the conclusion that it's looping and that it's starting again and that you can just go on. So it's like a presence which goes on after your visit. And what I did is, by shooting 75 different films, I did it in this rather tricky way, which is by shooting every 10 minutes of that day a completely new film, which would depict the light 10 minutes later, and which would exhaust the actors gradually over the course of the day, because they had to repeat every 10 minutes the same lines. So they start early in the morning, before dawn, around 4:50 or 5 o'clock in the morning, when the sun goes up, when they see nothing, and when the camera sees no light, and gradually the sun comes up, starts to lit up the whole scene, and so they act through that entire day, but not only for one scene, they have to do that for 8 different takes, because the 10 minutes is composed out of 8 different takes. And then afterwards, I know this sounds a bit complex, but I will illustrate it in a very simple way in a moment. After all those takes have been gathered, we were then able to make an edit which would show only the takes of, say, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And then the next film would be the one of 1:10 in the afternoon. So it would only be when you as a spectator would come back like 1 or 2 hours later that you would actually notice that something has changed in the atmosphere rather than physically moving. The only thing that's really moving is the story and the actors. So it's, for me, it's a bit like a contre-rendu with film. I have a hate-love relation with cinema, probably. And although there are a few masterpieces, I think, it's in general, it's a big prison for artists and for filmmakers in general, this dictatorship of the 90 minutes or the 120 minutes is something rather horrible. Besides that, most artists who embark on a film project, a feature film project, fail. So we have the choice here at looking at several fragments. I have selected a few. one at dawn, one around 8 a.m., early afternoon, 4 p.m., 7 p.m., sunset and evening. But in order to show perhaps for those who are not quite following the way it was made, I have actually added a small film just for the sake of illustrating now, showing the first four first 4 seconds of every film.
No money. I am leaving for Berlin in half an hour. Me? I'm leaving for Berlin in half an hour. I'm leaving for Berlin in half an hour. You call me. I'm leaving for Berlin in half an hour. You call me. I'm leaving for Berlin in half an hour. You call me. Me? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. What, me? I'm leaving for Berlin in half an hour. Me? Well, I'm leaving for Berlin in half an hour. Yes. Me? I'm leaving for Berlin in half an hour. Me?
This is almost noon, I think, what we're watching now. Yeah. So you can
see
in the geometry of the composition, the light is moving slightly to the right all the time.
Yeah. What, me? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour? You call me. What, me? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour? What, me? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. Me. I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. Yes. What? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. What? Me. I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. Me. I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. Yeah. What? Me, I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. What? Me? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. Yes. What? Me? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. Yes. What? Me, I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. What? Me, I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. What? Me, I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. What? Me? Yeah, I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. No. What? Me? I'm leaving for Berlin. Half an hour. What? Me? I'm going off to Berlin.
I'm going off to Berlin. So that we ended the last shot was with the lights on. So I thought instead of enveloping the whole scene into darkness again, we did end actually with one film where we switched the lights on. And surprisingly, I found out that the whole film crew was of course all of a sudden in the reflected in the windows, etc. So there's a lot of this production, there was a lot of accidents and they were just all part of it. It's more like a theatrical way of relating to cinema. And most of all, it's a sense of being there, which is important. The sense that the film is not happening in some abstract past in the studio, but is in fact going hand in hand with real time and with the passing, or one could say with the luxury of living a day entirely from morning to the evening. Of course, for the actors, as you have seen, but he was the best. It was very difficult at moments. And we will have a look at a complete sequence. But first, I think I will simply show you a few stills of the Bordeaux piece so that you get a bit of an idea. Okay. As you can see, we're having a few technical problems with the keynote. So I can see it, but you can't.
this little thumbnail. No problem, then we... It's very strange. Then we'll go right away for the more interesting part, I think, is there. If I can get this mouse to listen to me. Production pictures. I usually work with a very small crew, so I don't, in fact, engage on the level that filmmakers would do. We were shooting during 1 month with a small crew of between 10 and 12 people. So the person who was doing the sound was also cooking, was also acting, and so we did many, many tasks. We by ourselves was very intense, of course. And at times I was happy that the film happened because there were so many discussions. But that is a classic, I think, in film production, is that it's so intense that it's not always easy. You can see me here doing the camera work with my assistant. And essentially, concerning the composition of the house and the whole scene, I did a bit kind of the opposite direction of the way one should normally work. Normally one would have the story and then would fill in the story or would start looking for actually a good scenography or the right location, the right actors, etc., etc. And in my case, I had an observation of light, which I thought was interesting, which was the light passing the sun, causing shadows casted by trees on the walls of the house, which, by the way, is magnificent. It really is a real feast for the eye. And that was, in fact, my real subject. So I distilled a number of compositions in which I decided that this would be the scene for a story. And afterwards, we had to find a story which was boring enough not to be exciting and not exciting enough not to be too boring either, and so which would kind of hold you on your seat for 10 minutes. This is a very thin wall that was with an extra construction because the actor who had, rightfully so, he had fear of heights. It's an evening shot of the same position. So it's a lot of discussing and compromising, or maybe compromising is not the right word, but there's a lot of trying to find the right balance between story, composition, and essentially always keeping in focus in your mind that it's the thing that's actually really doing the job is what's happening on the horizon, on the walls, in the trees, the view over the city, etc. The house actually has this interesting hole, I will say, which is an elevator of some 3 by 3 meters, which goes up 2 floors because the initial owner, actually the husband of the lady who owns it, had been paralyzed at a certain point in his life. And so he was bound to a library, which is to our right here on the picture. So, and therefore, the architect had cut a moving platform, which, by the way, I think he repeated in more of his buildings, but which served me, thankfully, as a ready-to-use a piece of decor. I put my camera in that hole, and this camera, at a certain point, makes a very fancy movement. From low to up. And in film, you need fancy movements. This is one of these shots where you have everybody in the picture. There were other moments where the owner of the house would wake up at 7 o'clock in the morning and she would go to the bathroom and would just pass into the camera. And all that is part of the real-time shooting, so to speak. Was a lot of waiting at a certain point when we had gathered a lot of material, but still some was missing because What do you guess? It had to be sunny. And it had to be sunny all the time in the picture because we needed the shadows. So on cloudy days or rainy days, we couldn't shoot. And sometimes there would be a cloud moving just in front of the camera at the moment where you needed it. So there was a lot of patience.